The topic for today is pretty interested, I would say. I guess many of you have seen it. Maybe you already know and familiar with this. In this case, hope you will find some new things to improve. You might even use it, but don't know what is it. So that's why this topic is pretty interested, I guess. Let's go forward. And the agenda for today is pretty short. We will have some introduction. I will try to explain a little bit the history of and the reason of this topic. We will have spec overview of the conventional commits, briefly look at the tooling we can use to implement and enforce conventional commits in our projects. Then I'll going to do some short demo based on the tools placed in the slides in this presentation. And at the end, we will have a short section of frequently asked questions. Actually, there are a few things I think it's worth to bring up as a questions and cover them here. Okay. So let's start with the intro. From my point of view, unfortunately, Git at first glance is not very developer-friendly tool. And you know, in general, setting up Git workflow, it's like using a framework without knowing the language itself. It can be okay at the beginning. You just use it and learn it. But sooner or later, you might face with the problems. And one of these problems is the commits history, and it might be useless. And to avoid such things, we can use conventional commits, right? Okay. So look at this slide. Look at the example of the history. Does it look similar to you? Yeah. I want to say, because at the first commits are pretty precise, right? Because at the very beginning, we used to be precise. We start the project and we want to use good practices. We want to implement things in the right way. But later, when the project drags on, our commit messages get less and less informative. Also, the focus of the development might be shifted, like from quantity, like quantity and time get higher priority over quality and maintainability. So we spend less time on dev testing, code review, and documentation. If such product phase takes too long, it might turn commit history into chaotic and messy state. Let's check one of the examples I found when preparing the presentation. So seems to be the author of these changes had really nightmare. Besides this, I want to say that developers are lazy, and should commit messages be optional, we would use to skip it. Because when rules are not clearly defined, we use to bypass them. It's like putting dots in the commit message. If it's not prohibited, then we can use it. Next slide. Actually, this is the history I took from the cut of the history I took from the project I was recently involved in. And according to the changes to the history, seems to be author tries to fix a thing in multiple commits. And there are unnecessary commits which pollute logs and make history hard to read. And it obvious that functionality like Git blame become irrelevant in such cases. So what if the Git history looks something like this? So we have more informative messages. We can try to guess what happened there. We can try to even prioritize it. We know something was fixed, something was introduced, etc. Looks much cleaner and informative, doesn't it? So this is something called conventional commits. So what is this? It's the specification for adding human and machine readable meaning to commit messages. And it's inspired by and based heavily on Angular commit guidelines. If you are Angular developer and you go check the history of the commits of any Angular project, you might see such a format for the commit messages. Actually, they introduced this guideline 10 years ago. And then the authors and conventional commits inspired by this and introduced one convention which is applicable for all developers, not only for Angular. And I checked the history of AngularJS. It was even in first version before first release, almost 10 years ago. This is the first commit message that follows the convention we are going to check today. So pretty old, I would say. So who's using these conventional commits? Angular and Vue, but I have to say that Angular introduces this. Vue was inspired by Vue contributors were inspired by conventional commits in Angular team, and they use it to create their new one. But other tools like Electron, like Jenkins X, like Karma, like testing library, they use conventional commits to build the history and make it machine readable and to build automation process on top of it. So let's overview the specification of the conventional commits. In brief, it looks like this. This is the Beck-Snorr form. And as you can see, there are three parts, the header, the body, and the footer. The footer might be, footers might be multiple. And if you look at the example, it could be like this. So we have a header which split on few other parts. There is a noun word, which is a fit, it's the type. Then in parentheses, we have the scope of the change, and then we have description of the change. Below this, we have the body, which provides better contextual information on this. And in the footer, we put references or meta tags related to the change. Okay, let's talk about the type of the commit. So the specification defines two type of the commit. The first one is the fix, and we use it to patch a bug in the code base, and it correlates with patch version number in semantic versioning. The another one is fit, which stands to feature, and we use it when introducing new features in the code base, and it correlates with the minor. And there is a special character, exclamation mark. We use it next to the type of the commit, but before colon. And this lets machines know that the commit type is associated with the major version, Or we want to say this commit introduces breaking changes. Okay. So there are other multiple types. They are not prohibited. And from the Angular convention, there are 9 types more: build, CI, chore, docs, perf, which stands for performance, refactor, revert, style, and test. Here is the short descriptions. I just want to highlight a few of them. Style means not CSS, not markup. It means you change styles of the code, applying formatting or change it formatting, etc. It doesn't affect look and feel. It doesn't affect functionality. What else? Build the CI. There is two pretty similar, but the main difference is that CI is impacts their continuous integration. That's it. If builds and CI impacts build, okay, if the changes impacts the build and CI, it's also possible. You can choose either of them. Okay, let's move on. Optional scope. This is the second part in the header of the commit, and scope is the project specific at first. It might provide to commit type additional contextual information. It represents the area that you are performing the work on, and by the specification, it should be surrounded by parentheses and could look like compiler on common, you can see on the slide. Okay, pretty clear so far. So, and the third and required part in the header is the description. It should be the brief statement that that describes the work was done. It should be in present tense without a period at the end. And it follows the colon and space. Space is required. We should avoid long descriptions in case the commit should be described in details, then the details should be moved to the body of the commit. Description should be simple and clear. So the body, it's second section of the commit message. It's optional, and we use body that begins with the one blank line after the description inside the header, and we use it to provide additional contextual information about the code changes, and we can use a free form for the body. We can split it onto multiple lines. We can place any information there in any format. There is no strict rules. The footer, the third section of the commit message is also optional. It could be multiple, and it is expired by Git trailer convention. And Git trailer convention is the way to describe metadata. We can use one of two ways to describe footer, using a colon plus space or space plus hash symbol. If the footer provides such format, the machine will understand this is the footer. Otherwise, it might be interpreted as a body. Okay. And there is a special usage for the footer. If we put break and change it and describe the backward incompatible change in the code, the machines will interpret this commit as a commit which correlates with major version according to semantic versioning. Okay, let's look at a few examples. There are two commits I used from Angular history. As you can see, we have a header, which pretty clear, support knowledge coalescing into plates. We have better description, which describes details and how it looks like. And we have a footer, which provides reference to Git issues. And the second one tells us that refactoring work done, it's related to core part. Also, we have a clear description in details and reference to Git issue. Okay, another example I used from our project I'm working on. We have applied two fixes with short headers and clear descriptions. Okay, pretty clear, nothing specific, right? Okay, and I want to highlight how conventional commits dovetails with semantic versioning. So we have three parts: major, minor and patch. And we use fix type of the commit to correlate with the patch. We use fit, which stands to the feature, to correlate with the minor version. And we use one of two ways, exclamation mark next to the type to correlate with the major, or we use breaking change in the footer to make this association. Okay, let's actually the specification pretty short, pretty clear. Let's also talk about the tools we can use to implement that specification. So the first one is commit lint. It's another linter to check that commit message meets the conventional format. It works in the similar way as ESLint or GSLint or StyleLint. It's just a linter. This commit lint provides multiple configurations. You can just start using this without any extra configuration, but in our demo we will do some changes in the configuration to provide to make it more relevant to our needs, for example. And it works great together with Husky commit message hook and allows to lint commits before they are created. The second tool we are going to check is commitism. This is the CLI tool that prompts you to fill any required fields at commit time. And for example, in case you don't feel like memorizing the convention. So commitism has got you covered and provide you a friendly way to fulfill commit messages. So this is just a screenshot. We are going to check how it works later. And the third tool we are going to check is standard version. This is a package from conventional changelog monorepo. It allows us to the first bump version in package.json and package.log.json based on the history. It generates or increments changelog based on placed commits. And it allows us to create new commit, including package.json and package.log.json and updated changelog. So it does it for us in automated way. And besides this, it creates a new git tag with the version number. Okay. Also want to tell that conventional commits has few integrations. It's third-party integrations. There is a plugin for JetBrains IDEs. It provides extensible context and inspection inside the VCS commit dialog. It has extension for VS Code. It also has a plugin for Jenkins CI. If I'm not wrong, it was released a month ago, and it used to determine the next release based on the commit messages. And also there are multiple GitHub actions to enforce conventional commit style in project pull requests, because pull request, it's something we can't lint, but we can use GitHub action to make sure it follows the convention. One of them is conventional PRs. Okay, I'm going to switch to the demo, but before, perhaps you have some questions so far, please welcome. Maybe something wasn't clear. Let's cover it again. Okay, going to stop screen sharing for a minute and change the screen. Okay, can you see WebStorm?
Yes.
Okay, good. So for the demo, I created the simple project. It has no source code. It just has SRC.txt in place of source code. We use it for demo purposes. In the package JSON, I have installed following dev dependencies: commit lint CLI, commit config conventional. This is the shared configuration. Commit lint prompt. This is utility used to make CLI interactive. Also, we have commitism. We have Husky and standard version. I'm going to check it one by one. So there is multiple configurations. Let's look at the history of the commits right now. Okay, let it be git log one line. So there are more than 10, less than 20 commits so far. As you can see, I used some dummy messages. I tried to use conventional commit specification. There are already few releases, as you can see. Current release is 1.10. Also, there is a change log, which was generated by the standard version tool. So looks pretty clear, pretty similar to other change logs you might find in Angular and other projects. Okay, so let's start with the commit lint. So commit lint, we have defined it config. It's placed in the JSON file. It's called commit lint rc. It could be named differently. More details in the specification if the description of this tool. And we have defined few rules here. So I'm going to extend the default and the most popular convention and provide additional details. I want to say that header must be not longer than 80 characters. So the rules are pretty similar to ESLint, the definition of the rules, right? So we have defined type. So we can use only these types of the commits, only these seven. So fit, fix, CI, chore, refactor, etc. We have defined scopes. It could be full bar or release. We also specified the case for the subject. In this tool, subject means description of the header. It could be either lowercase, start case, or sentence case. We have defined length of the body line. It should be 80 characters and few rules regarding the leading plain clients. As you can see, we can use the standard config conventional and extend it in the way we like or project needs. Okay. The config for the commit is in, it tells, it just specify the path to the convention, and it's a kind of adapter for the conventional commits. It will use this configuration for the CLI. What else we have? Okay, the version, let's check it later. And let's try to, actually, let me remove this one. And let's make some changes here. Okay, let's imagine we have implemented one of the fixes. Okay, let's fix user name validation. Imagine we have this fix. Right, and I'm going to commit this change. Let me edit to works to working space, and I'm going to commit this change. Git commit with the message which doesn't meet the convention, like fix user name, like this. Okay. Yep. The commit was rejected, and it says that there are two problems found. One of them, subject might not be empty, and type might not be empty. When it happened? It happened in the commit message hook provided by Husky. So here is the hook. It's just a Husky hook to validate commit message before commit placed. Okay, let's fix the message. So we have the type, which is called fix, and we can use additional information, fix username validation. For these demo purposes, I do not use any branching strategies. It's just a main branch and commits into the main. Of course, in real project, it should look differently, but for the demo, I guess it's okay. And okay, one commit placed. Let's add another commit. Let it be feature. Imagine we have implemented some dummy feature, and I'm going to add it as well. Git commit. I'm going to use scope for this feature, let it be. And I'm going to use fit as a type of the commit and foo as the scope. I wanted to highlight that here is the defined scopes. Only those three are available. So I'm going to use foo as example. Okay, what's wrong with my keyboard? Okay. And some description. It doesn't matter right now, right? We just need to put this commit. The validation. Okay, what's. It and probably I have to use double quotes instead. Okay, another commit placed. Going to push it. Git push. Okay, seems to be I have issue with my SSH key, but it shouldn't be a big deal. Let's check the standard version. So the standard version is the package, the tool that could be used for the generating changelog. So the changelog, this is the example. I have already generated it based on the history we have seen. And in the package JSON, I have defined few NPM scripts. One of them is released. This is the typical one. It just call standard version CLI. In case we know that we need to promote changes to minor or patch or major, we can use flex release as major or as a patch as a minor. I'm going to let the tool determine the type of the version change itself. I'm just going to run npm npm run release. So, and as you can see, we have bumped version from 1.1 to 1.2. The same we have bumped in the package log. We have updated change log. Those three files were committed and the new tag version, new tag for the release was created. If you check the change log, so it added 0.2. So what we have, okay, it seems to be before the demo, I slightly corrupted the history, but doesn't matter right now. So we have the tool we just placed, description, and we have the fix username validation. Something was mixed. Okay. So that's the standard version in brief. And we can check the configuration for standard version. And it just has the, in this example, it has the list of the types which should be listed in the changelog. And it says list features in the section called features and list fixes in the section called fixes. Hide other types. And let's check changelog one more time. We have features and we have fixes. And if we want to check how markdown looks like, we have the list of changes and the reference to the GitHub. Those URLs might be configured, it might be rewritten. So for more details, please go to standard version package in case you found this useful. Also, I want to do the demo of the committees and tool. So how it works. In case you don't want to remember the format, you can add committees and it will help you to fulfill the messages using the CLI tool. So I have added the npm script commit, which is shorthand for git-cz. Let's run it. And okay, let's make some, it doesn't matter. npm run commit. It starts the tool. No file set, that seems to be fix two. Git add src. Let's run commit one more time. So, and just a CLI tool with a few steps. It tells you how the description look like, how the commit message should look like, and according to the rules defined in the commit lint, header max line length 80, it uses this config to build instructions for the commit. Let's type the commit. I'm going to use let me make some typo. Fit, and it tells fit is not available. I should use one of these. Okay, it should be fit. The scope. Okay, I don't know what's the scope. I don't want to use the scope. Just press the enter, and it says please use one of these available. If you don't want to use the scope, please skip it. Okay, skip the body. The description or subject, some new change, and the body, I don't want to use the body, and the footer, let me put the reference to the issue like this. Okay, so, and it creates the commit with the message. I just built in. Seems to be I have wrong SSH key placed before demo. Let me check that one more time. Git log. No, it seems to be it's okay. Yep. So this is the new commit and how it will look in the one line. And let's check how it could look like with normal comment. Some new change. This is the latest commit. And this is the reference. So the empty line and the footer, which is recognizable by either hashtag or colon next to the noun, to the word. So that's the short demo with the conventional commits and automatic changelog generation. Again, this is pretty simple stuff. Of course, it might be configured in details. It might different on your project or any other project, but I hope it gave you a good overview and things you might found useful or start using in your project. Okay, going to stop presentation for a minute to change the screen and continue this and continue slides. Okay, can you see summary slide?
Yes.
Yep. Nice. So what we get? What we can get with the conventional commits? More structured history of the commits. We can communicate the nature of the changes to teammates and other stakeholders in a clear way. We could get automatic generation of change logs. And also we can get automatic version bumping based on the types of commits landed. So for automatic version bumping, we should use other tools, either the Jenkins plugin or semantic releases or some other stuff, which weren't covered in this presentation, but still available. And yeah, we can trigger build and publish process based on the type of the commit. Let's cover a few frequently asked questions. Some of them are available on the official page of the conventional commits. I choose six of them. I think they are interesting and worth to be covered here. So, question: how should they deal with commit messages in the initial development phase? And it's recommended to proceed with conventional commits as if product already has been released. In other words, it's best time to implement conventional commits after releasing first version or MVP release. Why so? The problem of the initial phase that each commit might represent multiple type of changes. In one commit, we can introduce features, apply bug fixes, do some refactoring, even do some CI configuration, because this is the initial phase, right? But according to the convention, each commit should be atomic, like one pull request represent one fix or feature. On the beginning, it's hard to follow this convention. That's why authors and contributors of the conventional commit specification recommends to proceed after the release. Okay, the second question, doesn't the convention discourages rapid development and fast iterations? And they say it discourages moving fast in a disorganized way. And that's true. It helps to keep history clean to avoid chaos and mess in commits. It also helps you to be able to move fast in a long term across multiple projects with varied contributors. Imagine you work on multiple projects where more than 20, even 50 contributors, and all of them use the same convention. it could be much easier to understand what's going on when you switch in between projects. Okay, another question. How should I deal with the convention if I use to commit early, commit often? This is the common practice. I know many developers could perform multiple commits in an hour and about 20, 50 commits in a day. And that's okay. But please consider before creating pull request to squash your commits into a single one or use squash and merge option on a pull request on GitHub, because each commit should represent one change. If you have multiple commits, probably it's better to either split them or squash them. Also, you can consider to use methods like amend or noEdit to rewrite the history. And you can commit often, but technically it will be still one single commit. Next question. What do I do if the commit conforms to more than one of the commit types? Like in the same change, I have both feature and the fix. So it's recommended to go back and make multiple commits whenever it's possible. If it's not possible, then choose feature if you have both feature and the fix. If you have fix and refactor, choose fix. But please remember, the part of the benefit of the conventional commits is ability to drive us to make more organized commits in a pull requests. Another question, might I use custom commit types? And the short answer, yes, sure. The flexibility of the conventional commits allows teams to come up with their own types. Even you can create new types or introduce new types in the middle of the development in the later stages. It's not prohibited, but just make sure it is aligned with the team. Okay, one and the last question. How does conventional commits handle revert commits? It's a common case when we need to revert functionality, and the conventional commits doesn't make an explicit effort to define revert behavior, but they recommend to use revert type and put in the footer reference to the commit which is being reverted. So here is the example of the revert commit message. So this is the last slide about the conventional commits. And before we move to question and answers, here is the bonus slide, Gitmoji. This is another initiative to standardize and explain the use of emojis in GitHub commit messages. If you love emojis, then you definitely should go to Gitmoji dev and check what is it. It's less strict, I would say, than conventional commits, but still provides ability to automate processes on top of your commits history. That's it, guys. I'd like to move to question and answer section. Thank you all being here. You're welcome.
Thanks, Andrii.
Thanks, Andrii. I just have one